Thanks. Yep, all looking good. Hi everyone. Well, welcome to the first day of Women's Work. We're so excited to be here, and I'm delighted to be joined with the one and only PR pro Laura McCabe from Jawdropper to chat Francesca. All things about DIY, music PR and marketing, because we all know it can be like a really it can seem like a real big mammoth of a task whenever you're just after writing, recording your music and you're ready to release, but you don't know where to start. So that's kind of what we're going to try and break down today. So just to kind introduce ourselves, my name is Francesca O'Connor. I've been working in the industry side of things for about 3 or 4 years. Started really as an artist manager, managing a couple of artists. And really the past year or so, I've kind of gone more into the PR marketing route for independent artists across Ireland. So just really trying to raise their profile within Ireland and a bit into the UK. As well, my business is called Makeways Management. You can check it out on socials and websites and get a wee gist of what else I do. I'm also the NI representative for AIM UK as well. So it's really about breaking down that geographical barrier between London and all the events that happen over there and all the opportunities that are there that sometimes we kind of feel like we're left out of sometimes. So with AIM, really, it's my job to kind of bring all those opportunities to here so we don't miss out on anything. So keep up to date with that as well. You can check them out. So that's Association of Independent Music. I think their website is aim.org.uk. So you can take a reread there and all their free resources they have. With templates you can download, and then they have like memberships as well that you can kind of get more in-depth resources there as well. So that's just a wee bit of a background on me. I'll probably pass on to Laura and she can probably explain all the wonderful things she's been doing. So go ahead, Laura.
Thanks, Francesca. What a nice intro. And I'm so, so glad to be sharing this panel with you. I was absolute honored to be asked to do it with you today. You've definitely been someone I've always kind of followed as like, God, she's really good at what she does. And one day I'll be a great PR person like her. But I've kind of been involved. Yeah. Hi, everybody. My name is Laura McCabe. Great to see everybody here today. I'm currently working with Jawdropper Music, who are based in all around Ireland, really. We kind of have acts from all around Ireland and we look after management and PR and some consultancy services. So I've been doing management for a few years, kind of half in, half out while working full time. And then I kind of got the opportunity during the pandemic to actually give it a go full time for the first time ever, which has been really exciting. And then also at the same time, I actually just decided to give PR a proper go and have not looked back since. It's been a really, really great experience. I've only been really doing it for full time for the last few months, but even in the last few months, I've just learned so, so much. I've definitely still lots to learn, but yeah, it's been a crazy pandemic, to be honest. It's been a lot of ups and downs, but I'm not going to look back. So I've been really enjoying it.
Brilliant. Yeah, I know you're saying there you still have lots to learn. I have lots to learn. Like, I don't think we'll ever stop learning whenever it comes to PR marketing, because like it's just always progressing.
I know. It's always changing as well. So you've just got to keep on your toes.
Yeah, exactly. So I think we'll jump in and just kind of we'll start really with the basics here, and we'll ask the question, is PR marketing really necessary? You know, can we not just put up our track on SoundCloud and hope that people hear it? Or, you know, do we really have to have a big campaign that lasts for months? Or, you know, what are the essentials we really need?
Yeah, great question. And I mean, obviously we're here, I'm sure everybody will know straight away that we're here to say yes, marketing and PR is probably very necessary. But yeah, it's like, you know, I'm sure you agree as well, Francesca, but it's kind of like anything that you do, like PR and marketing is just kind of telling people about it. So there's been so many times over the years that I've seen really great artists that I admire, or, you know, people releasing music, and I've noticed that there hasn't been any kind of campaign or talk about it. And I just see tracks being uploaded online, and I just always feel it's a bit of a disservice to the artist, because as you say, like they spend, you know, so much money recording it and mixing it and mastering it and getting nice artwork done and getting nice press photos done, maybe to like give it a bit of a bump online. But sometimes there's like no talk about it in advance. And I just always think it's a big pity, because like artists deserve to have their work talked about and shouted about from the rooftops, like in advance and especially after it comes out as well. So I don't know if it's a thing maybe with artists that they feel they're like showing off, or like that they don't have the audacity to kind of shout about themselves in this kind of way. But I'm obviously always one to fly the flag of like, tell everybody what you're doing, tell about all the great stuff. Like you've put months of work into making this track or this EP or this album. Like, why not spend a few extra weeks before it comes out, giving it the attention it deserves and telling that story through like even simple bits of PR and marketing. Like it doesn't have to be this huge campaign. Mm-hmm. It can just be like, what story do I have to tell? How am I going to break that down into like a few little steps, a few key little days before it comes out? And who do I need to tell about it in advance? So you can kind of keep it simple as well.
Yeah, I think you touched on a really good point there about artists not wanting to, you know, shout about themselves. Like that is completely it. And that's what PR is. It's about bigging yourself up and like promoting yourself. And like some people can get really turned off by that because it's like, oh no, you know, it's not a big deal, or oh no, it's not that good of a song, or do you know, that sort of
totally.
Way. Like, no one else is gonna know about it unless you tell them about it. And you know that's completely right. Like, you know, they spent all this time writing it and really laboring over it, and it's something that's so emotional as well. That, you know, it can be quite a vulnerable thing putting it out there. And you know, I can understand why people may feel a bit hesitant about it. But
yeah,
like I said, no one's gonna know about it unless you actually tell them.
Yeah, so, and I mean, artists are these beautiful, emotional, important creatures that we do need to look after. But and I know it's not comfortable shouting about all the things that you're doing. And, you know, some of the greatest artists I've worked with just hate, you know, shouting about themselves. So it's probably why PR people are hired a lot of the time, because they can do the shouting for them.
Yeah.
But, you know, when you're starting off, like, you've just got to tell, everybody wants to hear about it. You know, everyone is on your side. Everyone, it's like if you're doing a gig, you have to almost imagine everybody in the audience. They're already on your side. They're already there. They want you to do well. No one's sitting there kind of critiquing you of going, oh, they're a big show off. Like, look what they're doing. Like, yeah. Everyone wants to hear the good news of you writing new music, releasing new music. So like, definitely go through the effort of telling them, because artists are worth it, you know?
Yeah, absolutely. And you know, someone's song could be exactly the thing that someone else needs to hear sometimes. Like, it is all a personal story. And you know, it might seem really like personal and vulnerable to you, but if you don't say it and you don't promote it and people don't know about it, then that could be possibly something that someone doesn't hear and that they really need at that time, and something that they can relate to and really resonate with. So yeah, it's about letting people know that, no, your songs are of value and they will mean so much.
Recording in progress.
As well. Sorry, I just want to double check, make sure people have their recordings on mute, or their webcams on mute, just like so we're not kind of double back on each other. And also just kind of, sorry, I just want to reiterate, we're going to have like a Q&A at the end as well. So I know some people have been like dropping their questions and messages into the chat box, but we'll probably come back to most of them at the end. Put your questions in there if you want anything answered. Sorry, just kind of wanted to interject that there.
That's okay, bit of homework, bit of housekeeping, that's all right.
Yeah. Okay, so we established, right, definitely, you know, it is a good thing to do PR marketing, even if it's just, you know, shouting about it on your social media, just telling people, even if it's in a small way. So if we kind of want to, you know, do more than just post about it, what do we really need then to consider if we're thinking about, you know, doing a PR campaign, or I have a single coming out or an album coming out, what sort of things do I have to have in place to make, you know, an effective PR campaign?
There's definitely a couple of things that will help people get started. I think, I don't know about you, but the words PR campaign, press release, like, used to just give me a bit of fear of like, what are they? They're kind of those terms that you're just can get a bit put off by, especially when you're starting off, and especially when you're like, I've never done this before, how am I supposed to know how to do this? And I promise you, it's much, much easier. I don't want to make it sound as easy. It's actually a really easy job, because then I'll have no work, because everyone will just go off and do it themselves. But it is definitely much easier than I think people give a credit for. And it does require a bit of time. Like anything, it just requires a bit of time, a bit of structure, a bit of thinking about it, a little bit of planning in advance, just like the way you would write a song or plan to record a song. Like, thinking of how you want your PR campaign to work, or how you want your press release to look, just takes a bit of planning. There's definitely a few key things that would, you need to kind of have, I suppose, in your armory in order to be able to tell people your full message of what's going on, when you're releasing, who you are. So things like an up-to-date bio have like a short and a long version. Sometimes, you know, people might want a short one. Sometimes people might want a long one to use across like press releases, or, you know, if hot press are sharing it or something, they might want a longer form bio. It's handy to have song bio, a couple of lines or a paragraph or two of like, what's the song about? Who wrote it? When did you write it? Where were you when you wrote it? A bit of background, what instruments are involved? Like what genre of music it is? Like just a bit of context to like give to somebody when they read it, they're like, oh, I can actually imagine what this sounds like before I've even listened to it.
Yeah.
So trying to keep that really tight.
Like building a song.
Or if it sounds like another artist, or, you know, for fans of James Blake, or like, you know, if there's synths involved, like something that you can kind of catch people's attention of like, oh, I actually love 80s pop music. Like this is going to be right up my street. Mm-hmm. Press photos are great to have. And something I always try and stress with people is, you know, visuals are quite important as well when you're releasing music, because it's a huge part of your brand, I suppose. And I know a lot of artists don't like thinking of themselves as brands or small businesses, but really, like, they are. Like any small business, like, how does your brand kind of act? What kind of, you know, imagery does it use? Is it nice, dreamy kind of photography? Is it like really abstract photography? Mm-hmm. Like whatever it is. But, and this doesn't need to be, I think we talked about this before, of like, you know, I think it's easy to kind of get all caught up of like, oh, I need these professional photographs taken in the studio, or like I need these really, really like high class like pictures of myself. But like some photographs, you can just get a friend of yours who's got a really good eye and like head out to like a nice location, or find a nice wall somewhere and just take a couple of snaps, or head out and about with a decent phone. And like, it doesn't need to be in a studio or something terribly like expensive or anything. Like something simple that captures the essence of you, bit of your personality, you know, maybe throw on something really cool looking that you feel comfortable in, like something to help you kind of come alive.
Yeah.
A couple of those are always really handy.
That's a really good point. Yeah, because like I always feel that people are more likely to see you before they hear you. They're gonna like, you know, be scrolling down on social media and they'll be like, you know, they're gonna see your image before they actually click on the track and listen to you. So, you know, having that image kind of marry up with your music is really important. Like, you know, whether you want to go for, you know, film photography, if you're that kind of lo-fi or folk, or, you know, something like that, you know, with that sort of grittiness to it, or if you want to have something that's like super slick, you know, if you're pop, your alternative, you know, you want something that's like really digital. And, you know, those like small wee differences can actually change someone's perception of who you are as an artist, you know, before they even listen to you.
And even as humans, we're naturally visual people as well. So like we see things and we kind of, our brain makes decisions about them. So like if you have a couple of photographs of yourself, or even if there's a couple of photographs of you playing live somewhere, like have that nice mix of nice imagery. You know, it just kind of helps build the story out a little bit and show people you're taking yourself a little bit seriously. But yeah, I always try and, you know, there's one artist I'm working with at the moment, and I think press photos is just something that really just seems like a bit of a mountain at the moment. And I'm just like, get a friend of yours who's like good at photography or has a good eye, and just go out with your phone. You've got a really good phone. Just take a couple of snaps. It doesn't need to be something too complicated. So definitely. But yeah, a couple of good snaps for yourself along with those bios.
Sorry, I was going to say, just talking about photos, getting like, I think you touched on it maybe briefly there as well, getting, you know, like behind the scenes shots as well. Doing like, if you are in the studio and you're in recording an album, you're not going to get that time back again. So if you document everything, you know, whether it's just like videos or like just a, like you're saying, a wee photo or like just taken on your phone, these are all wee things that you can use months later. So you'll really appreciate just taking the time to do it there and then.
You're speaking my language. My favorite word I probably say to any of the artists I work with is just assets. I'm just like, build up a content bank, always be like, just kind of always thinking about, okay, what kind of, if I am doing something, what kind of imagery can I capture? Because yeah, as you say, like phones these days are just brilliant. So they can capture really, really great videos, really, really great photographs. And if not, just borrow one of your friends and take a couple of snaps and buy them a coffee or something. But yeah, I think it's really important to have a nice visual story.
Hey, Claire, thank you so much for taking the time to have a call. Appreciate that.
Zan, can you meet? Oh, there she's gone. Lovely. So we've got our bios and our press photos. A couple of the things that we got to have is an MP3 version and a WAV version of your song, or your EP or your album or whatever it may be, even throwing them into Dropbox or Google Drive, like definitely don't be sending anybody huge attachments or, you know, sending over MP3s. I think everyone's pretty savvy at this kind of stuff right now, but I'm a big Google Drive fan. So I kind of dump everything into Google Drive, whether it's my, all the bios, all the photos, all the MP3 and WAVs. Like some radio people prefer WAVs, some people prefer MP3s. So if they're going to be playing your song on radio, you definitely need to kind of give them a listening link as well as giving them a link to download the file that they can actually use. Mm-hmm. That's always handy to have as backups. I think what's also important to stress is whenever you are kind of putting together even a very simple press release, have everything available in one go. So I think I always used to get a lot of feedback from people of being like, I can't find the listening link. I can't find the link to download the WAV. Can you send it to me again, please? Mm-hmm. And a lot of people in media like ourselves are just super busy and just, you know, might not have time to write back to you and say, can you send me on that WAV? Yeah. So you actually might miss out on a chance if you don't have everything kind of in one place ready to go.
Yeah.
So definitely don't forget to kind of give them those links, even if it's a Google Drive link of like, if you like the song, here's a link to download whatever versions you need. Or even in SoundCloud, it's really handy that you can download straight from SoundCloud as well. Sometimes people miss that though. So I've found over the last while, giving them actual links to files is just much easier. Mm-hmm.
Especially like streamlining it as much as possible. So yeah. It's like providing all the links, you know, so they can kind of listen to it in their own time as opposed, you know, you could cut out 3 or 4 emails just by going back and forth with different links. So just giving it all at once. But like you said, definitely links, not attaching anything to the actual email. And if possible, have it all in the same folder. You know, here's this link and then this one and then this one. And, you know, it's scattered throughout the whole email. Just put it all in one folder, like you're saying, Google Drive. It's honestly, my life is on it.
Literally, so, my whole life is on it.
Exactly. So having everything in something like that or a Dropbox or, you know, just have ease of access, really. Mm. Yes, I totally agree with that too.
I think the trick of PR, and this is where maybe it might not suit certain people, so it's definitely a skill to try and work on, but I think PR is just all about being super organized and having all of your information in one place, distilling it down so that it's nice and kind of bite-sized. You're not sending them like pages and pages of stuff. You're not sending them like a drive full of loads of things, that you have everything kind of, even within your drive, having a folder of press photos, having a folder of MP3 and WAV, you know, making everything that you do as easy as possible for people to digest when they read it, because the nature of the industry right now, and it's actually just ramped up loads. I don't know if you noticed it, Francesca, but like PR wise in the last few months, it's just ramped up so much. And I felt the pressure from like different radio people or different, you know, blog people being like, who might reply to me 2 weeks later and be like, I'm so sorry, I'm only seeing your mail now. My inbox is just completely inundated. So whenever someone does get the chance to read your email, I think distilling everything down and making something really easy to read, really easy to find, whatever it is you want to talk about, whatever it is you want to share with them, whatever you want them to listen to. I'm definitely someone who has had to learn that, because I want to tell them everything. I want to throw everything in and like tell them, you know, X, Y, and Z and like all the great things this person has done. But really, like, if you send someone a big long email or a massive press release with loads and loads of stuff, like, we're human, we're not going to take everything in. So it's kind of, the more things you throw some at somebody, the less likely they're going to pick up the points of information you want them to actually to read. So trying to distill it all down, keep it really short, keep it really tight, focus on the main points, I think is really important. There's two other things I think you should probably have on your list of things to go, is just links to your social media, because usually a lot of radio DJs or blogs will tag you if they share your work or if they review it in like a weekly roundup. They'll want to tag you and share, you know, your handles online, to make sure they can find you, especially if you're an artist where your name might not be automatically easy to find online, or if there might be, it's something that doesn't automatically come up on Facebook for whatever reason, giving them all the links. And then a handy list of press quotes is always something that I think really helps tell your story. And if you don't have any, don't worry, because the more releases that you do, the more you will pick up these things. You will pick up a little press quote here and there, or even like if someone plays your, you know, champions your work, you can list what stations have played you with press quotes as well. I have got into the habit now of just getting every artist I've worked with, every campaign they do or anything that they've done, if anyone says something about you, start one massive press quotes doc for yourself. save it and just track everything that's saved. And that means whenever you're putting together your press release, you can just kind of dip into that really easy, pick out your two or three best ones, and then kind of put it into your press release. Yep. Sometimes different press codes work for like different reasons and stuff. So track everything. Again, it's back to the organizational kind of side of things, that I just track everything and try and make my life easy for myself. So I'm not constantly searching of like, oh, what did Hot Press say about that person that time? That'd be a handy quote to have. And, you know,
I completely agree. Yeah. And I think press codes are the thing that's going to grab people's attention first. You know, like whenever I am writing up a press release, I would put the press codes at the top, because that's the great version. You obviously want to big yourself up as much as you can and kind of give yourself that credibility from, you know, blogs or radio or whoever it is. So kind of putting those up maybe at the top of your press release is what's going to grab someone else's attention.
Definitely. Because if, especially if it's a radio DJ that is like similar to the person that you're targeting and being like, well, this person played it, so that means, well, I've also found as well, the trick I've started doing is if I, you know, if I'm targeting somebody in kind of like in, say, Northern Ireland, if I talk about RTE playing them and BBC Radio Ulster hasn't played them, I try, I think if you can almost play media off, each other sometimes as well, or vice versa. Yeah, yeah. If you're talking to BBC Radio Ulster, you're like, well, RTE Radio 1 played it. So like, what, you're missing out here. Usually if somebody hears of the other kind of competitor in a different market playing it, they'll be like, oh, we're missing a trick here, so let's get on board. So you kind of have to tailor it to who you're talking to as well.
Yeah, I totally agree with that too. Okay, so obviously this panel is called A DIY Guide to Music PR Marketing. So we're not talking we have, you know, thousands and thousands of pounds to spend on, you know, a big PR campaign. So, you know, how can we do this on a kind of low budget? And, you know, how can we do it all ourselves for people who either don't want to, you know, hire an external PR person or, you know, they don't have the money to spend on that. So how can we make the use of like free tools or ones that are of low cost to kind of, you know, get the most out of our money?
Yeah, definitely. And then, like, you know, most artists starting off won't have loads of budget. They, like, you know, won't have anything at all, like, when you're starting, because, you know, as we all know, like, even when you're starting out gigs, like, they're not hugely well paid. But you start off maybe 50 quid, 100 quid for like a support slot. So trying to build up your own budget, or even if we're working full time, trying to make the music thing happen, like, yeah, you're not going to have loads and loads of money, but there's definitely so much you can do yourself that's free. It just takes a bit of time and a bit of planning and a bit of organization. But there's definitely loads of free tools, like, you know, even putting together like artwork. If you don't have money to hire a designer, or if you don't have money to hire a graphic designer or something, you know, Canva is an amazing tool. You can kind of just hop on. They've actually loads of different templates. You can create loads of nice social media kind of things for there. Like, they have like Instagram post templates and Instagram story templates. And that's a really nice free tool. To use.
Yeah, and it looks like professional as well. And, you know, for those who maybe aren't as, like, you know, graphically creative, they have so many templates, they're like, yep, that kind of suits my brand, just swap, you know, like switching the text and, you know, your colors, and kind of make it more you, you know, just make it as you make it as personal as you want. So yeah, Canva is really brilliant. And I think, you know, for anybody who doesn't use it, get on it now.
Yeah, I only discovered it recently through an artist I'm working with, and I was like, how did I not know about this? This is genius. Yeah. But yeah, I can't even really believe it's free. It's really, really good. But
I was gonna say, like, just quickly, like, you can now like schedule on it as well, you know, because that's probably another thing that people maybe are wondering about, you know, like scheduling social media posts and stuff. But that's something you can actually do inside the platform now as well. So you can actually streamline kind of all your posts going out as well.
Yeah, and those kind of tools are so helpful with saving time, because especially, we'll probably talk about social media a little bit more later on, but that's a huge part of your PR marketing. Like, you have to kind of think about, what am I doing on social media? So anything you can do to kind of save yourself some time, because I don't know about you, Francesca, but I spend most of my time doing social media, and it's just, it's really time consuming. And, you know, you've got to be all over it all of the time. Well, it certainly feels like you do anyway. So anything you can do in advance to kind of make things easier for yourself or save yourself some time, like, do it. It's the same with like when we're talking about free tools, like, free information is online everywhere in terms of like radio DJs or people write, like, journalists or people to send your work to. Again, it just takes a little bit of time to kind of start that research and start building that kind of database. I would highly recommend anyone out there listening. And it's something, again, I only started doing myself a couple of months ago when I actually started doing PR, because I was constantly just looking for people's email addresses that were in my inbox. And I was like, why do I not have a database already? Like, how am I at this point in my life where I haven't started a database? So it can be super simple. Just break it out into radio, blogs, print, you know, Spotify maybe. And just if you come across any email address anywhere, and so many of them are free online, and there's so many of them easier to find. Just track them all and save all of them. And it would be so much easier and so much more, like, less time consuming for yourself instead of trying to look for them each time. I'm actually going to copy into our chat. I came across this. Some of them might be out of date, so definitely check. But Imro put up a really helpful link of, like, radio contacts. And other media kind of contacts. So, like, the information's out there, it just takes a little bit of time to kind of figure it out. But if you put a bit of time in, even spend like an hour or two once a week being like, okay, I'm gonna do a blast of look, trying to find radio DJ emails. Or, you know, one thing is if you see another peer of yours doing something, or you see, oh, Totally Irish, John Barker on 98FM played their song, mm-hmm. like, how do I get my song on there? I think without badgering people too much and without maybe asking too much people, definitely ask your peers, being like, how did you do that? Like, how did you get that? And I think that's something we'll probably touch on later on, but mm-hmm. asking for help is like, you know, get involved. And as long as you're not, I suppose, asking too much of people, or like asking one person maybe for like, can you send me all your contacts? Or like, if there's something that you can't find yourself, mm-hmm. like, ask for it and people will gladly hand it over. Like, you know, me and you would do that all the time, or people like my peers in the industry, something I just can't find, I just throw out a message to me like, can anybody send me a contact for this? I'm looking to get in touch with this person, have a really good track or whatever.
Yeah,
so
yeah,
definitely ask for help.
Completely. Yeah. And I mean, like, we're a very small music industry here. So, you know, you're not too far removed from the person that you need. You're going to be two or three people away at an absolute max. So, like, yeah, you're never too far away from the person you actually want to be in contact with. And most of them are, like, very open and welcoming to actually give out their contact name if you can't find it. You know, I'm sure you could ask somebody and they'd be more than happy to send it over, or like to actually receive you know, music from people. I think some musicians can kind of feel like, oh, you know, but you know, you don't want to be badgering them, or you know, you don't want to be coming across like, you know, I don't know, you're a pest in some way, you know, like they kind of think that there's maybe a buffer between them and the DJ or you know, the journalist or whoever it might be. But a lot of them are actually looking for new music because they want to be ahead of the curve as well. So people actually shouldn't be afraid to approach them.
And remember that, like, you're making their lives easy. Like, if you're sending them a good track that's suitable for their show with a nice simple press release, all the information and download links, you've actually made their life, like, they kind of need you more than we, like, it's a really two-way street. Like, they need us the way we need them. They need new music, they need like great new music. So, like, of course, by us getting in touch in advance and giving them all the info in advance, it kind of makes their lives really easy. So don't forget that they also need you too. They, like, you're not the one always asking for something, you're actually giving them something that they need, you know.
Completely. So we touched a lot there about, you know, time is really like the most important thing here. You know, it just kind of takes a lot of time to kind of like collate
a lot of time.
It really, really does. And that's really what the crux of it is, just spending a lot of time sending emails and researching. So if we're kind of sticking with that sort of idea of time, and really that, you know, whenever you have a release date set, that's set, you know, it's coming out in that date. You can't, you know, well, I know sometimes you can move it maybe, but you know, you really shouldn't. If you have your release date, stick to it, kind of base everything around that. So, you know, if I say I'm an artist and I have a single coming out in a couple of months' time, say I have a thing coming out in September, what should my timeline look like? When should I actually start considering, you know, a PR campaign, and when should I actually kick things off?
So if you have a release date set, it's always great to work backwards. So say I'm an artist right now and I've got a release date, and I'm like, I want to bring something out maybe in August or September. I don't want to alarm people too much by trying to think too far in advance, but this is what I do in my kind of profession. This is what I think will help make sure your message gets across. I'm not saying it's the right way or the wrong way, but it's just something that I've tried and tested, and it's worked in a good way. So I usually start thinking 6 weeks in advance of a release date, just kind of to give yourself enough time of picking the date 6 weeks in advance, at that stage to start putting together elements of like, have you got your final master track? Have you got some of your press photographs? Is there a music video to go with it? Have you got your press quotes? Have you got, like, you know, who am I actually going to be sending this to? So 6 weeks in advance, I would just start thinking about all those kind of things, gathering them all, getting your Google Drive ready, getting your Dropbox ready, whatever it is. One thing that I will say is try not to maybe pick a release date until you actually have the artwork and the finished track.
Yes, yeah, I agree.
You'll save yourself a lot of time and energy and stress if you don't try to pick a release date until you have at least those two things. Mm-hmm. And all the other things like your bio and your press photos and a music video, whatever, they can all come, but don't try and put yourself under pressure until you have those two things. There's a couple of times I've set a release date with somebody and I've been working towards it, and then, you know, comes the time where we need to upload it to Spotify, or I'm starting to put a press release together and the track isn't finished. And, you know, it's just, it causes all kind of stress. So
yeah, absolutely.
Get that ready first.
Exactly. And like whenever people, you know, kind of, I understand as well, like from a management perspective, if I'm working with an artist and they have a track and I'm like, oh, I just cannot wait to get this out there. I want to get it out now. But sometimes that's the worst thing you can do is say, I'm going to release this in 2 weeks. You know, sometimes I would have someone approaching me for PR saying, I'm releasing my track on Friday. Can you do PR for it? You know, and it isn't enough time. So it's kind of, you know, thinking ahead of the game as well. So yeah, really, how long is it going to take for me to create that buzz and to let as many people as possible know that I'm releasing it on this date? A couple of days isn't going to be enough time for you to
do that. Totally. It's, you know, if you're having a party, you wouldn't invite people 3 days in advance. You might invite them like a few weeks in advance. So it's the same with anything. Like if you want to do something and you want to tell people about it and give yourself enough time, you just need to allow yourself enough time. So I suppose 6 weeks is like minimum. Like if you want 8 weeks or 9 weeks or 10 weeks in advance release date, start getting the stuff ready, go for it. But that's kind of the rough kind of time I have in my head. And then when you're kind of 4 weeks out of release date, that's when you need to be pitching it to Spotify on Spotify for Artists, pitching it to Deezer and Apple Music if you use those as well. I'm a bit lazy and I only pitch to Spotify, but anyway, that's kind of, and Spotify ask you in advance to pitch it 4 weeks in advance. So it's something that you need to be ready, and you need to have your like Spotify for Artists, the 500 character pitch that you have online, that needs to be ready to go. But that 4 week deadline, you need to have your track with your distributor in the stores before that 4 week deadline, if that makes sense. I think that's something that always catches artists out with, that they think they're like, okay, I've 4 weeks ahead of the date, I'm going to put it up in my distributor now. And then that might take a week, it might take 24 hours, and then you might miss that kind of 4 week deadline that kind of Spotify look for. So something just to watch out for.
Sooner the better is kind of like the mantra, really, isn't it?
You know, definitely.
As much time as you possibly can. I think, mm-hmm. Yeah, you're totally right there as well. It's the 4 week deadline with Spotify, you know, to kind of get that consideration for editorial playlisting, which is a lot of people kind of want whenever they release their music. So kind of allowing yourself at least that amount of time for pitching.
Again, if longer, if, you know, it's not like it has to be exactly 4 weeks if you want to go a bit longer, but I would try and stick as close to the 4 weeks as possible. And at that stage, I suppose, if there's like, you know, if you wanted to approach BBC Radio Ulster for like Across the Line for a premiere of the track, or if you want to approach 909 for like a premiere maybe, or any kind of like, if you're doing an EP and this is like the last single before the EP release or something, any longer form media, usually print or maybe a premiere, if you're looking to kind of reach out to people that you want to secure something in advance, start reaching out to them like 6 weeks or 4 weeks in advance. Try not to leave it too long because they just forget about it, I think, except for print. Print, you can go like 3 minutes advance and it still might not be enough time for them. So it all just depends. But around that time, about 4 weeks in advance, you know, that should be really like, you should really have an idea of like, do I want someone to have a premiere of it? You don't always have to do a premiere or not. It's just maybe something nice to have on your social media and like a first kind of taste before it actually comes out like a few days later.
Build up your press quotes.
What's that? Exactly, exactly. Add to your press quotes. Mm-hmm. And then we kind of get into crunch time. So like 2 weeks ahead of the release date. So say it's coming out on a Wednesday, Thursday or Friday. The Monday week previous to that, so kind of two working weeks before that, I would start, and I think people differ on this, so I'd love to actually hear when you start sending things to people, but I usually send them that Monday before, the 2 Mondays before the release date, and I send it a press release and I send it a short intro of who they are and like summary of who they are and all that kind of stuff, and being like, this is coming out, get ready, blah blah blah, all that kind of stuff. Finalize any kind of prep, finalize your lists of contacts that you need to be sending it to. And then probably around that time, it might be a bit early, but if you want to start shouting about it online too, go for it. You know, it's nice when the PR, I think, in the background and emails lines up with the Spotify stuff publicly. So that if a radio DJ does get a press release and they're like, oh, I haven't heard this person before, let me check out their Facebook or their Twitter or whatever. And they go in and they see you talking about it. They're like, oh, cool. Okay, this person's actually got a plan together. They know what they're doing.
I totally agree with you as well. Like whenever I'm working with an artist, I try to match up with them as well. So the day that they, you know, announce a single coming out, that's the day I'll start to reach out for blogs and PR, or if not, I'll reach out a couple of days sooner just to kind of give them that wee sort of insider knowledge. So yeah, I agree with you as well, starting around about that time, because you don't want to be getting airplay or, you know, blog coverage too soon before your track comes out, because people aren't going to be able to take any action. So
there's nowhere to listen to it. Yeah, okay. Totally.
I can't go to Spotify and stream it, or I can't go to Bandcamp and buy it, or iTunes or anything. So it's kind of about leaving that sort of sweet spot, you know, kind of giving them a little taster, but it's going to be coming soon so they don't forget about it and they can still take action, because it'll only be a few days.
Yeah.
You know, so if you get a premiere a day or two before the track, they're getting excited to hear it. They don't have to wait 2 weeks before it comes out. It's only a couple of days. So you're kind of able to retain that sort of listenership a bit better.
Totally. And even like 2 weeks in advance, I don't mean 2 full weeks, but yeah, that Monday, it's kind of like a week and a half almost. I think starting the conversation then, because you want to check back in with them again on your release week, and maybe even a polite follow up again the day it's out or the few days after it comes out, being like, by the way, this came out, I think it would really suit your show, would love to give it a spin or some support or whatever. Like, once you start the conversation, I would never probably send one email to somebody and expect them to play it again. The amount of emails they're getting, we're all human. If you can give people a few reminders, like polite reminders, and not be like, why haven't you sponged my email? Like, this is the greatest track in the whole world. How can you not be playing this already everywhere? Like, I think a big thing about the PR game is being respectful and being polite, being understanding that these people that you're emailing, they're all human too. They all have full-time jobs. They all have families and they all have lives. And, you know, they might just miss, your track might be the greatest song in the world. It might suit their show down to the ground, but they could just be absolutely up the walls. So like one or two reminders, either the week of release or even the day it comes out, doesn't go straight either, because, you know, we all need reminders. Like, there's some things that come into my inbox, I'm like, oh, that looks great, I must get back to that. But then something might happen, or I might get a call and just forget about it. And just because we're human, you know?
Yeah, absolutely. No, I totally agree with what you're saying there as well. I think I heard someone else say, I think it was maybe from a radio DJ, I can't remember. They said it's the rule of three. You know, they kind of limit themselves to three times, you know, asking, you know, kind of giving those prompts and those little reminders. Anything past that, it kind of feels like you're badgering them. And, you know, sometimes it's a polite way for them to say, I'm not interested, if they don't
know
you, know, so you kind of have to respect their decision there as well.
Totally. Like, you know, I totally agree. And part of the job with being PR and like shouting about yourself and telling people all these great things is reminding people. But yeah, it's just knowing when to kind of read the room. And if they haven't come back and you've kind of given them all the information they need in a nice, polite way, like, it might just not be something for them at the time. It doesn't mean your song's not any good, or it doesn't mean that you're not any good. It just means maybe they're really busy, or they have other stuff coming in that week they need to feature, or anything. So definitely always keep trying. Like, there is people I have been emailing for years and I've never heard from, and then they'll play the song and I'm like, oh, so they did get my email. Like, I didn't even know if they've opened it or not. So it's something like, be persistent, but just be respectful as well. And don't be annoying people. But if it's something that, like, it's a blog or a show or anything that you just know will really, really suit their audience, definitely keep reminding them. But just, yeah, know when to move on, I suppose.
And I think you can touch on all of that, you know, saying it could be like weeks or months later that they actually play a track. something that I actually just kind of want to share, and I totally forgot about it. Honestly, one of the tools I could not live without is War Music Monitor. So really check it out. It is like, it's not expensive at all. It's a radio monitor where you can upload your track, and in real time it monitors where that track is getting played from, you know, from what radio station at what time in what country and, you know, city. It's so specific and it's so easy to use, and I think it's literally as little as maybe like €5 a month for a single track. And upload like an album or an EP, and you can pick, you know, it can monitor all the tracks on it, and it's just a really easy way for you to kind of keep track. If someone does play it months later or whatever, you know, you'll always know. You don't have to rely on them getting back to you and say, I'm playing this, you know.
Because you're not going to always get a response. It's one thing if anyone can take anything away from today, you have to accept you're not going to get a response from everybody, but that doesn't mean that they're not seeing it. You have to have faith that people are seeing your emails, like, and like repeatedly go. If, you know, one song, say you've got a few singles coming out, you don't hear back from the first single, that doesn't mean you don't go back to them on the next single. As long as you feel that their audience and the music that they play or that they write about or they feature suits them, always keep trying, because you just never know. They could have taken a couple weeks holiday. They could be working somewhere else. They could be like just not in the headspace, or they might be really busy, and they might catch them on the next single. And they're like, oh, I've seen that come through before. I actually liked it. Never gave a spin. I love this new single too. Like, I'm going to share this as well. So definitely don't give up with people. Like, you know, keep reminding them. I actually just dropped a link for Warm in there. I also recently started using this, and really helpful. It's not that expensive, and if you're going to put money into anything, it could be this simple tool, because you're not going to hear back from anybody all the time. They might not tag you every single time online, so this is a great way for it to be registered to see, oh, today FM did play that song, or BBC Radio Ulster did play that song as well.
Yeah,
it's really, really handy.
Something else that's actually, you know, quite a good wee sort of thing to use with Warm as well, you don't just have to track your own artists, but you can think, who do they sound like? And you can actually track another artist's song, or artists in general, and see where they're getting played. So then you can actually reach out. Yep, sneaky. So
I didn't know about that now, Francesca. Yeah. I'm learning from you now.
Yeah, like you can say,
genius.
Played whatever track from whatever artist. I like my band, or, you know, me as an artist, I sound really similar to them. I think you'll really like my music too. You know, send in the link. So it's kind of a good way to kind of find new people. Definitely. As well, new champions of your music and new audiences as well. They mightn't even be in your hometown or your home country. It could be in, you know, a different place altogether, and you mightn't even know, but it's by tracking, you know, just where another artist is getting played, you can tap into their audience as well.
I think that's a really good point in general anyway, that if you see the likes of Across the Line playing a certain artist that you sound like, or you feel like your music sits close to, having that knowledge and even opening with that of being like, I'm sending you the below because you played so and so recently and I think you'll like my music, or because you wrote about this band, my band's really similar, I think you're going to really, and like, I suppose journalists and radio DJs, like anybody, we all have egos and we all like to hear when people have heard our work. Like, radio DJs love to know the fact that people listen to their station and people like what they play and people like their choice of bands. So like, I think the more you can personalize things going out to people, and the more information, without, you know, I totally understand no one has time in the day to research every single DJ and every single blog, but the more research you put into it of what kind of stuff they play and who they play and, you know, any of that kind of stuff, you can definitely get closer to them listening to your stuff, because they're like, well, this person's taken the time to actually engage with my show and engage with me as a professional, so I'm more likely to engage with them and see what they're about too. So personalizing now, like, there are MailChimps out there for doing up nice press releases and sending out a blast to everybody. I'm a bit old school and I actually send emails directly to every single person, and I tailor every single email, and I'm not joking, it's hundreds of emails. I'll block off 2 days of my time. One day I'll tackle radio, one day I'll tackle press and blogs or whatever, and I will go through each one. I'll obviously copy and paste the bulk of the email and the press release, but I'll top and tail it with like any kind of personal information I can, because again, these people reading it are humans. They don't want to be, and like a big no-no is probably do not copy and paste everybody's email into a CC or anything. If you are going to do that and not personalize it, at least put it on the BCC so that not everybody is getting each other's information and data, and our favorite words, GDPR stuff might come up then. But as if you can personalize as much as possible, or even mentioning, I would love if you could play this on your show across the line, yada, yada, like calling out who they are and their show and like something, or like, I read a really great article you wrote about this band recently. I really liked it. I'm really connected with it. I think you're going to really like my band because X, Y, Z. So trying to personalize it really simply is, I think, really, really effective.
I 100% agree with you. That's like my number one rule, is just be a human first. You know, actually all PR is about building relationships with people, like, you know, and actual meaningful connections, not just asking all the time and, you know, just, you know, treating it like a cold call. You do kind of want to have that sort of personal connection. And so the more that you kind of are personal to them, they'll give back to you as well. So like you're saying, you like tailor every single email you send out, you know, so it's personal to everybody. And I really do appreciate that. Yeah, and the worst you can kind of do is send a blanket email saying hi. It's so blasé, and it could be to literally anyone, because it probably is to anyone. But taking those a few extra minutes just to personalize that email can be the difference between getting covered and not.
Yeah, no, definitely. Because I think, you're totally right. Reminding they're all human behind a computer screen. And yeah, they might be working the biggest radio station in the world, but they're the ones maybe opening an email, or the producer might be opening an email. And if they see that you've taken the time and to understand their audience, understand what they're doing, they're definitely more likely to give you the time of day than just kind of getting like, oh, this person's just stuck me on a huge mailing list. And, you know, I don't even know if this is going to be for me. I think that's another point as well, is when you are sending things to people, it's really important to know that they are playing music or writing about music that is similar to yours. Like, there's no point me sending a really folk track to like FM 104 main daytime playlist, because they don't play folk music maybe during the day as much as they might play pop music or dance music or whatever it may be. So really knowing, like, it's, and same goes for if someone runs a folk show and you've got a pop song, don't waste your time, don't waste their time by sending them a pop song, because they're just going to be like, I don't play pop music, I play folk music. So I think knowing and saving yourself time too, like not sending it to every single radio station in the country, actually figuring out, okay, well, what radio stations or what blogs talk about my music? Because I think, you know, even with the Thin Air, you know, I recently sent a pop track to them and they came back being like, you know, we're more of like indie or alternative, or like they don't really write about maybe big massive pop anthems, where a 909 might be someone who might feature pop music more than indie alternative rock kind of music. So knowing their audiences will help you connect with them better, I suppose.
Yeah, it's a lot of investigation, a lot of research, isn't it?
Oh, so much research. But the more you do it, the more you pick up, and the more you like, as long, like, the more you keep going with it, like, you just learn so much and it becomes way more second nature the more you do it. But it is a lot of effort, and but it's worth it.
You put the time down a lot as, like, the more times you do it.
Totally.
Or I have literally so many more questions I actually want to ask you, but we're quickly running out of time, and I know we're going to have a wee Q&A section at the end. So if anybody has any questions, feel free to drop them in. I might ask you maybe one more question, maybe before, if anyone has any questions. So we've hit release day, and, you know, we've shouted about it and everything, and we've got, you know, our premiere, it's already been sorted, and, you know, we've kind of got that initial coverage. How can somebody kind of extend the life of their release post-release day? What can they do, you know, just so the release doesn't end as soon as the track comes out?
Mm-hmm. Really good question. And it's one that definitely comes up a lot with me. And it's another thing to kind of remind people that, like, once you get to release day, that doesn't mean the campaign's over. Mm-hmm. It's kind of, the campaign's kind of starting then. Like, you've done all your background work, done all your emails, maybe you've done a bit of social media, you know, promotion and shouting about it in advance, then the song's out, you know, that's when the real work, I suppose, kind of starts. I was working with a brilliant artist recently, and we worked on our very first campaign together, and it was release day, and I was messaging her, I was like, look at all these great things, this person said this, and blah, 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 didn't hear from her all day, and I was like, where's she gone? I spoke, ended up catching up the next day, and she just didn't even realize that release day was, like, it was a thing. So, like, she was like, oh, I just thought it was kind of out, and that was, like, that was kind of it. And I was like, no, where have you gone, you mad thing? Like, this is when all the things I mean, you have to start shouting about, like, has there been any press coverage or media coverage, or like even putting up a post of like, everybody, it's out today, go and listen to it on Spotify, and making sure those links are fresh on top of your pages and pinning them to all your pages and making sure everything's there, really easy to find. So yeah, definitely be around for a release day. And that's kind of when the campaign really kind of kicks it up a notch publicly anyway. Yeah. So any extra content you probably have in your bank of like, do you have a lyric video that you've made? Do you have any kind of music video to go with it? Again, you can do these super cheaply, or, you know, try and find somebody, maybe even like film students in college that might want to work with you and help you make a cheap music video for free, or like at a really reduced rate. Or if there's anyone that you see that has really nice visuals, like get in touch with them and like, who did you work with on this? This is great. And try and find a really good team around you, and try and work with them on, if there's things that you're not good at, whether it's videos or even visuals or something, or social media, try and pull in people if you can from the start, and see if there's people that want experience in doing what, you know, the areas that you need help in. But yeah, I suppose any kind of, as you said earlier on, any kind of behind the scenes stuff of you, like any little cute videos of you guys recording, like, or working on a song together, or, you know, rehearsals together in a band, or if just by yourself, or that's where your press photos are going to come in hand. So any kind of nice visual content you can have, you don't even need to have a music video every single time. But I think it's really important before release day is to kind of sit down and make that social media plan, you know, the 2 weeks advance of release day, and then the 2 weeks afterwards. It's kind of like, what am I talking about? What am I saying? You could put up nice lyrics of the song to really like remind people this is what the song's about, or anything like that.
Yeah, I know.
Anything you've got, go for it.
Yeah, exactly. And you know, you're saying there about, you know, like videos and stuff like that, and graphics and all that sort of thing. Sometimes you can even do things that, you know, aren't going to cost the earth, you know, like a big asset. It can literally be, it says it's an album you released or an EP. You could take each track for, you know, for like 4 or 5 consecutive days, however many tracks are on your album, and go and, you know, dive deep into each song and say, you know, this is, you know, the process of writing the song, this is where my inspiration came from. And you could do a sort of track by track sort of thing, mm-hmm. that only goes out to your mailing list, or if you have a Patreon, it only goes out to your patrons, you know. So mm-hmm. kind of just those little intimate kind of information that really you just kind of want to hold close until after release day, and that's maybe something special you could share.
Yeah, definitely. I think keeping stuff back is definitely a nice idea. Mm-hmm. So yeah, that's where you're 6 weeks in advance, where you're sitting down, you're like, okay, what's my bank of content as well? What do I have in my armory to use over the next few weeks, and trying to plan that out. And I think PR and marketing, when you drill it right down, it's just storytelling. You're just telling people a story, telling them who you are, telling them what your music is about, you tell them what you write about, what inspires you. You know, I think also personal content is hugely important. I think the balance has kind of flipped a lot on social media. It used to be this super slick professional, like, you know, world of like, no one want to put up a bad picture or anything. But I think it's almost turned into like, it's just way more, you're way closer to your audience than we've ever been before. There's very little restrictions between you and your audience. So the more personal you can be, the better. Like, there's a rule of thumb I came across in some conference recently, and it's kind of haunted me. So now I'm going to haunt all of you with this. But apparently, every time you put up one business piece of content, you really should be sharing 8 or 9 personal pieces of content, which is crazy. But it could be like a video of you, you know, making bread or going for a swim, or like just things that you like to do, or just even little videos of you noodling around the guitar, or like just really simple personal things about yourself that it doesn't need to go into too much detail. Like, you don't need to give away your whole life, but mm-hmm. the more you can kind of relate to people and make you appear human, people might relate to you in like a really, really nice way. Yeah. And might then connect with you and be turned into fans of your music, and they might then buy tickets to your gigs or buy and want to support you because they're like, this person's a human and I really get her, or him or them or whatever, you know.
That's completely true. Yeah, like the more personal you are and the more you can actually build that kind of like relationship with your fans. Like, I think engagement is obviously a big term that's kind of used on social media, but it's the same in person as well. You want to engage with people, you kind of want to have that back and forth with them, you know, like, so like you're saying, if they're making bread, oh, I'm going to share my recipe, you know, and you know, there's going to be that sort of like conversation that you can open up that your person outside of music as well, you have all these different other facets of your personality that you can share as well, you know, so, you know, people just kind of want to know who you are outside of music as well, and then that could be another audience you could be tapping into as well.
Totally. But yeah, storytelling, tell nice stories to people, and they might engage with you, you know, and just be yourself and be authentic and be human. And behind this big mask of being a musician, you are just a human at the end of the day, so why not show that as well? And because other humans out there might connect with you stronger.
Okay, so I don't know if any questions have come in yet, so we might just do a quick round of do's and don'ts.
Okay.
To kind of finish us off. So we've probably touched on a lot of them already, but maybe just concisely, can we get some do's? That's something we all should consider when doing PR.
Okay, do's. I think we've touched on as well, but definitely do your research. Mm-hmm. Start your database now. Take that IMRO list that we shared in, or start looking around at different things online and start gathering your contacts. Even if you've no music ready to go now, start your research now. It can be a really simple database. I think do be patient. You've touched on that earlier on, but like, you know, these things take a bit of time. The first release you send out to people might not land on every single person's desk. It might not get played on every single station, but have some patience, keep going, keep trying. This is a game of determination. And it's something that I've had to learn over the years of like, you know, just stay positive, stay determined, stay really, really confident of what you're doing and yourself and the work that you're putting out, because it's really important to have that as well. Especially if you're starting off with just you and you've no manager, you've no publicist or anything, you've got to really instill yourself like all this confidence and ambition and drive. So keep the patience, you know, do all that nice stuff for yourself. And I suppose the last one I probably might say is, I touched on it a little bit earlier on, but yeah, do be respectful of people, because other people they're working in their jobs, they're trying to run a radio show and they're trying to write a blog, and you know, just a little bit of respect can go a long way. And as you said, our music community here on this island is teeny tiny. Mm-hmm. So it doesn't cost you anything to be nice to people. So just be respectful and be patient and lovely.
And is there any major don'ts that we need to avoid?
Probably the opposite then of that is just, yeah, don't spam people. Don't be upset if people don't come back to you every single time. Don't get disheartened. Keep going. Like, definitely don't give up hope. As I said, it might take a single or two to kind of get you in the industry or kind of get you recognized by certain people. But yeah, definitely don't give up hope.
I think that's a great one.
I kind of want to end on a positive one, because yeah, this is really hard and it's not easy and it is really challenging, but it's worth it in the end if you put a bit of research and a bit of time and a bit of practice into it and give yourself those couple of weeks running in advance of a release coming out. I guarantee it will pay off so much more afterwards, and it's scary, so don't be too hard on yourself either.
I know an overnight sensation doesn't exist. It takes years to be an overnight sensation. So yeah, it takes time for everybody. Anyway, guys, I think that's us finished.
Thank you both so much. Right, before you go, I just want to say that I'm looking at the chat box and there's lots of so inspirational. Thank you. That's been so helpful. So job well done, Laura and Francesca. The headline is keep the faith, put the work in, and you will build connections. Thank you both so much. And while I have everybody here, if you want to skip over to the Center's YouTube page, we have a really special event going live now. It's Irish Women Music Managers Forum in conversation piece. Mm-hmm. So that'll help you understand what female managers, of which I'm a part of, Francesca's a part of, and Laura's a part of, we're part of this collective, and we're all female managers trying to basically find opportunities for lots of artists, and this is just a little pilot program we've brought together, but there's just lovely stories in these video pieces. So nip over to the YouTube channel now, learn a little bit about some of the faces that are busy behind the scenes, and thank you all so much for attending. And actually, one thing to say is we had the same amount of people turn up for this session as registered for it. And that's the first in quite a lot of our online sessions. We get as much as 50% drop off. So it shows how important PR and marketing is to a lot of people. So thank you both, Francesca and Laura, for giving such honest wisdom. It's really appreciated.
I just put my email in there as well. If anyone has any questions, please don't be shy. Find me on social media or drop me a line in my inbox and I will promise to try and help you if you have any questions.
That's mine in there too. Thank you so much, Laura.